That's on the reason, yeah. So let's just look at what he said so far about security. You know, there's been several comments broadcast that he's made, which people lampoon say, look, he left out some key elements about security. But this time, he did say that, yes, indeed, with respect to the farmers and herders clashes, that he's, what was that word they used, reinvigorate security agencies. Should we be optimistic? Doesn't that give some ray of hope, saying, look, they perhaps, as people had said, if they were looking the other way, with this speech, they can't afford to?
Well, it sounds good. Let's see what the president does. He was too silent for too long on the Fulani herdsmen.
You mean even before he went on his medical
leave? Yes. But now he says, from this, we assume that he would be more vigorous in tackling that issue. And I'll tell you something about insecurity. The reason why you have all these groups in the Southeast complaining about being disenfranchised, being marginalized, is because the minute the president took office, his first key 28 appointments, 7 from the Northwest, 7 from the Northeast, 7 from North Central, only 4 from South South, and only 3 from Southwest, and 0 from Southeast. From then on, the people of the Southeast felt, look, this man doesn't care for us. What else did he do? All the appointments after that, he even said that his concern was for people who voted for him 97%. Look, let us say all that's in the past, but let's not forget the reason why we are where we are. Unrest and insecurity is not only Fulani herdsmen or Boko Haram. It is the people in the Southwest and the Southeast who are complaining of being marginalized. Because I tell the people in the Southeast, you are not the only ones marginalized. All of us in the South are marginalized. Because how can Lagos have 20 local governments and Jigawa 27? And Kano 44?
Let me ask
and Lagos 20?
Let me just butt in here. How do you equate the president's, in his speech, when he says that every Nigerian has the right to live anywhere in the country, as against the October 1 deadline, which seems to still subsist, about the Igbos leaving the north?
The South South has also said that people should leave their own geopolitical zone. All that is just talking anger. I hope they're not serious, because frankly, that is totally reckless and irresponsible.
Hope is not a strategy.
So what?
Hope is not a strategy. What if come October 1 and this is actually happening?
Well, the point I'm making is, it is irresponsible and it is reckless. And this is where the government should show leadership and deal with people who threaten such things in Nigeria, because we're still one country. Why should anybody say, get out of... That shows you how deep the resentment is and tribalism. And if you are the leader, and in your own pronouncements, and in your appointments, you show, you imply that you are also ethnocentric, because you cannot have 14 security chiefs and 11 of them from the north. It's not fair. And that will create discontent and discord across the nation.
Looking at
and that's what we're getting now.
Some of the highlights of the president's speech says he was distressed by divisive comments. Social media comments have crossed our national red lines. Would it be out of place if people think that, okay, with this, we may just expect some sort of, is it regulation about comments not crossing the line? Would they send something to
the
National
Assembly?
Where
is the line? That's the issue. Where do you cross the line in a democracy? Look, the president still has to come to terms with what it is to be the leader of a democratic country. People can say anything they want to say, and you can take them to court. And if they are found guilty in court, they will pay the penalty. That's a democracy. I don't know what people have said across the line. If people speculate that the president is dead and the president has, that's just stupid talk. That's not to say that you're going to arrest them for speculating. You just ignore that.
All right, let me add
because
this.
Because if you keep on attacking, anybody says something against you, you go after them, you want to turn this into a police state, it will boomerang.
Let's wind down with this. I mean, you know, when the PDP was in power, at the time there was a doctrine of necessity. We've had several amendments to the constitution, but they didn't see it necessary at the time to ensure that there's a time limit with which a president can be away for. So do you think they will then have any, shall I say, moral rights now to begin to lampoon the law when they had the opportunity and didn't do it?
The PDP was in government, was in power for 16 years. It was too long for one party to be in power and not get corrupt.
Or not do make that amendment.
No. I'm saying they had all sorts of shortfalls. They had all sorts of shortcomings. We know now. And by the way the PDP is coming back now, it seems that the PDP has learned its lesson. You know, I was myself very critical. I was at one point very supportive, but I found too many loopholes, too many problems. But the PDP has learned its lesson. There must be an opposition party in place. So the president should expect fireworks very soon.
You said 16 years in power and not be, it's inevitable you become corrupt after 16 years in power. How possible is that?
It's inevitable. Power corrupts, absolutely. Power corrupts, absolutely. I knew it that they were in power for too long. In a democracy, you know, look, a lot of the times what happened in those days, people were rigging elections.
So why are they coming back?
People are rigging elections.
Why do they claim to want to come back?
When the APC has not been there for 16 years.
Well, APC has been there for 2 years, it's like 20 years. APC is a disaster. APC is not even a political party. Why do you think they can't have a convention? Because who is going to call the convention? Is it Buhari or Yegu APC? Is it Bola Ahmed Tinubu APC or Seraki APC? They cannot come together. The president is not the... Look, some people don't believe the president, Buhari, is the leader of the party. Some people believe Bola Ahmed Tinubu is the leader of the party. They have serious problems. And that is why they are running this country aground. I don't know. I don't think you realize how much crisis we have now. Measure it by the quality of life. People are dying on the streets of Nigeria of hunger. Now, we've never seen anything like this before. Forget about PDP, forget about APC, talk about people, individuals. One of the things that is happening in the PDP now is when they lost power, all the people, the corrupt people in the party, they are no longer relevant within the party. In fact, none of them showed their face at the National Convention.
The corrupt people in the PDP?
Oh, yes. People that have been exposed. So we are glad that this war on crime is going on.
Okay, so
let's expose them across the board. What is wrong with the war on crime, on corruption, and why it's not succeeding? President thinks he's succeeding. I don't think he understands what's going on. Let me tell you, if you prosecute only PDP criminals and you cover for APC criminals, everything will come crashing down.
All right,
that's what's going on now. The president better realize that's the work he has to do now. He should clean his own house in order for us to have peace.
The PDP
in the country
does have criminals and which should face the law, so perhaps they shouldn't cry wolf because there's none, as you have established, for those of them who are facing.
Oh, no. Yeah, but Jonathan said it.
All right.
You have a problem, you face the problem.
By the way, Nigerians will remember. We will find out what the APC thinks about what you have said about their party in just a moment. Dr. Pierce, thank you for coming on this morning.
Thanks for having me.
We're back in a moment. Don't go away.